Hello everyone. So today I am going to discuss my lecture video on violence against children part 2, in which I'll be focusing mainly on child trafficking. If we try to define trafficking, we can define it as an organized crime which violates all tenets of human dignity and rights. So it's organized. It is done by an organized syndicate or gang, and in follow a routine process which is involved. It occurs for various purposes. Trafficking can be done with anybody, for children as well as for adults, and it is done for generating human resource to be involved in labor, child labor, or even bondage labor, commercial sexual exploitation, and many of the time for illegal organ trade. There are several vulnerability factors which impose a children or even an adult for trafficking. It involves poverty. Those who are poor, less facilities for livelihood, they are more vulnerable. Illiteracy, illiterate people are more vulnerable. Those who have lack of livelihood options, and those who are affected by man-made or natural disaster, which again impose them to poverty and deprivation. If we talk about India, it faces both in-country and out-country trafficking, and the data suggests that 90% or more of the total trafficking cases are in-country, and 5 to 10% are cross-border trafficking, which are mainly reported from Bangladesh and Nepal. There are also reports that people from India are being trafficked to Middle Eastern countries, Muslim-dominated countries, and these children or adult people are trafficked there to work as domestic help, manual labor, child marriages, and even prostitution. When we talk about specifically trafficking of children, we find that majority of these trafficking occurs in a systematic process. So there is a systematic process of trafficking. It includes 5 steps, and the first step of this trafficking is recruitment. So in this step, the person responsible for identification and recruitment of a potential child closely monitor the activity of a person or children, try to find out his or her surroundings, and try to ascertain whether this person is suitable or fit for trafficking or not. In second step, the identified person is transported from one place to another. So usually the person is transported from their house or place of safety to another places, unknown places, for the trafficking to occur. In third phase, transfer occurs where children are resold to another person. Basically, in transfer, either the child can be sold to another person or child can simply be transferred to another gang member. And it is just such an organized crime that the person recruiting and person taking transfer are usually ignorant to each other, so they don't know each other, and there might be multiple transfers involved. So it is not that the recruiter gave it to other person who is the end receiver. It is not. There can be multiple transfer agents in between to make it very difficult for police and law making agencies to trace where the child have been shifted after the trafficking. The fourth step is harboring, in which the children are kept against their will at a place where they are deprived of their basic needs. They are now kept hungry, thirsty, and they are kept there until their resistance goes down and their resistance is over. So harboring is a process in which the children are harbored at a place until it is ensured that they will not speak, they will not protest when they are sent to or sold to any other person. So harboring is basically to minimize or to end their resistance for what happens to them in future. And then the final step comes, which is receiving the children or accepting the children for sex, for child labor, for domestic help. So in this step, the children is transferred from the abducting body or the trafficking body to the end user. If we talk about the means that includes how the children are trafficked, it includes abduction or kidnapping by forceful use. The child by forceful use or tactical use, the child is kidnapped or abducted from its place of safety. There may also be involved selling, in which the person involved in trafficking buy the child from its place of safety. They also sometimes use force to abduct the child. So many in some of the cases, the child are used forcefully abducted. In some cases, childs can be threatened to get the kidnapping. They may threaten for their life or the life of their beloved ones. Few cases occurs when child is deceived to for trafficking. In such cases, the child is given offers about job, offers about valuables, and is many of the times offered good lifestyle and good leisure products, and in this way the child is transported. And finally, the child is also trafficked by the use or abuse of power and authority. Many of the time, people involved in their protection and in their caring may also involve in the trafficking process. If we talk about the responsible factors that contribute to the trafficking of children, we find that there are five major factors, although there might be many other factors also. So the first factor which lead to the trafficking of child is related with general interest in increase of prostitution of children. So it is specially linked with increase in demand. The more is the demand, the more is the likelihood that the child will be trafficked. So there is a general increase in demand of child prostitution, child pornography, child labors, and child marriages in many of the cases. So for catering to these demands, the children are trafficked. There are also social and economic factors that contribute to increase in poverty and child neglect for families. And when these things happen, the child is either sold or the child run from their home to get a good life, and then they are caught by these traffickers. Also, the children who are living in extreme poverty are more vulnerable for child trafficking. Cause in poverty and deprivation, they usually are a very easy target for traffickers in the exchange of few money or a good lifestyle or a promise about a job. Also, one of the major contributing factors for child trafficking is inadequate legislation and application of law. There are weak legislation related to child trafficking, and whatever legislation there are, all these are usually hardly used by lawmaking agencies to curb the child trafficking, and that is why these incidences are increasing. Also, the lack of appropriate services and policies are responsible. So there are lack of policies to protect children living in poverty, protect children living in difficult circumstances, to protect children who are abused or neglected. So in absence of these appropriate services and policies, the children are more vulnerable for trafficking. Now, If we consider who are these trafficking agents, we found that in majority of the cases, family members, usually distant family members who somehow have the responsibility to take care of the children or act as agents to these family members want to get rid of the responsibility of the children, and thereby they sell children usually for small amount of money or in exchange of goods. It is also found that those who have been older sex workers, they once their demand is over, once they find it difficult to earn their livelihood, they involve in child trafficking and try to sell or buy small children so that their earnings is revived. There are also organized gangs who are involved in child trafficking, and they use it as the means of earning money. There are also brothel owners who always need new members in their brothel homes, and that is why they involve in sell and buy of these trafficked childs. There are also syndicates that are organized on more organized level, and usually these syndicates are spread over multiple cities within the country and many of the time cross country. So they are more organized body who take support of local gangs or local agents to organize these trafficking incidences on a more wider global level. Many of the time government officials who are responsible for the protection of child might also be involved in trafficking of children. Local and foreign nationals who involves in trafficking of children for satisfaction of their needs, be it sexual, be it the need for domestic worker, or be it the need for a marriage partner. And in some cases, it is also found that due to extreme poverty and deprivation, parents also sell their children to the traffickers. Now, let us talk about who are the children which have higher risk for trafficking. It is found in studies that girl child have more are more at risk for child trafficking because the demand for girl child is higher, while the male child is used mainly for child laborers. Girl childs are used as child laborers, as child prostitutes, as child pornography, as well as for child marriages. So the risk for them are higher. All these children between the age of 4 to 17 years are at risk for being trafficked. Usually, child less than 4 years of age is at less risk, and child more than 17 years are also very less likely to be trafficked. Those children who run from who belong to rural or urban areas and who are in search for work for survival are easy target for these traffickers, cause they traffic them in the exchange of job promises. Children who have left home because of poverty, deprivation, violence, or any other reason are more at risk, cause once they are found at roads or at places where it is very much visible that they don't have any adult people to care for, they are more at risk for these trafficking incidences. It is also found that children who have been sexually abused previously are at more risk, cause due to these abuse they are less likely to protest in these trafficking incidences, and also due to their abusive experiences they are more likely to leave their home and are more likely to be neglected by parents. Children also who run away from homes or places of safety, especially children who run away from child homes and child care units, they are also at greater risk, cause they are abandoned on roads, on streets, and then they are more at risk of being in the eye of the traffickers. Now let us talk about the modus operandi of the traffickers. So they first target the vulnerable family and children. So this is also the recruitment phrase when the local trafficker, the one who is more aware about the local situations and maybe the member of the local community, who try to target, find out the vulnerable family and children where the child is, can be easily available, and they try to identify situations if the child could be bought for some money, if the child could be trafficked in the promise of, in false promise of job, or where the child could be transferred for a longer and for a longer time they will not be noticed by the family members. So once these targets are fixed, the local trafficker offer the family or the child food, temporary shelter, or he may involve in regular payment of money to the family or child. He may give new clothes, costly gifts, so that the family or the child is well acquainted with the this person and consider this person trustworthy. After this trust is developed, the local trafficker offer the child or the family promises of good education, good employment in the city. He advertise false work opportunities. He always try to portray how good children are at places who he sent for jobs. And then under these false promises, parents either sell their children, send their children for job, sell their children for some money, or the child itself leave the home and go with this trafficker to another city for the job or good education or living opportunities. Now let us talk about the provisions that are made nationally and internationally to curb this child trafficking. If we talk about international, the Convention on Rights of the Child and its optional protocols are there, which is ratified by India also and in many countries, which prohibit the sale of children, child prostitution and child pornography. There is also Convention of Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, which is also again ratified by Indian government also and many countries of the world who try to prohibit all forms of women discrimination. UN Convention Against Transnational Organized Crime is also signed by India, which ensures that its member countries create pass laws which are against the transnational organized crime. India has also signed the protocol to prevent, suppress and punish trafficking in person, especially women and child trafficking. So India is party to this protocol as well as many other countries are there. And this issue is well represented in the Millennium Development Goals of the United Nations also, that these are the concerns to protect the right of children. There are also some constitutional provisions in the Constitution of India. So Article 23(1) of the Constitution of India says that trafficking in human beings and beggar and other similar forms of forced labor are prohibited, and only contravention of this provision shall be an offense punishable in accordance with law. So the Indian Constitution strongly prohibit trafficking on human beings, and owing to these constitutional provisions, there are various laws related to for the protection of children from trafficking is passed. One of the very earliest act is 1956 Immoral Traffic Prevention Act, which has been amended by 2013's changes in RPC and which is also under we know it under the umbrella term of Nirbhaya Act. So in Nirbhaya Act there are many provisions of child trafficking are added, and thus this 1956 Act is changed, modified accordingly. There are many provisions in the Indian Penal Code which talks about various procedures to penalize people who are involved in trafficking. Many provisions related to trafficking in Indian Penal Code is also amended by the Nirbhaya Act. There is also Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2000, which talks about ways and measures to care for and protect children from all the hardships. And also the amended 2006 Child Marriage Prohibition Act, which restricts girl child and even boy child below a certain age for marriages. So the child marriage is illegal in India. There are some national policies and plans that were made to help children live a good life. Some of these are National Child Labor Policy 1987, which talks about various guidelines related to the engagement of child as labor, and various laws to protect the child rights and child from the labor activities. Also 2001 policy for empowerment of women, protect women as well as girl child. National Plan for Action to Combat Trafficking and Commercial Sexual Exploitation of Women and Children 1998 is again a national policy which were based on sexual exploitation, and it also covers the trafficking of children for sexual purposes. National Plan for Action for Children 2004 is there to protect children. And Integrated National Plan of Action to Prevent and Combat Trafficking of Human Beings with special focus on women and children is there to restrict and to protect children from trafficking. Also, there are various commissions that have been set up to help children. National Commission for Human Rights is there, which always take cognizance of such activities which involves child trafficking. National Commission for Women is always active when it comes to trafficking of women. And National Commission for the Protection of Child Rights is there, which deals with all kinds of activities which tries to hamper the children's rights. Other than these commissions, the government also came up with Ujjwala Yojana, which is also known as Radiance of Light. On 4 December 2007, it was a comprehensive scheme which was launched to prevention and trafficking and rescue, rehabilitation and reintegration of victims for trafficking for commercial sexual employmentation. This scheme is implemented by NGOs. And this is in scheme has six components. The first component is prevention. In this prevention, it is idealized that NGOs will form community vigilance group, adolescent groups, and would involve in awareness and sensitization of important functionaries like police, community leader, and will prepare materials, hold workshops and training programs for the sensitization and prevention of child trafficking. The second component is rescue, which involves safe withdrawal of the victim from the place of exploitation. So it involves if a child is identified being trafficked and involved in any activities such as child labor, child prostitution, etc. This incidence helps for the rescue of the talks about the rescue of this children from that situation. The third is rehabilitation. Once the child is rescued, they must be provided safe shelter with basic amenities. They must be provided counseling if needed, medical care if needed, legal aid for their rights, and after then they must be provided vocational training and must be trained in income generation activities for the long term rehabilitation of the children, and so that they can be well integrated into the society. There is also provision for halfway homes. They are something between the rehabilitation center and the society. So these halfway homes are prepared for phased reintegration. So once they are rehabilitated, they are trained in vocational activities, they are not part of the rehabilitation center, rather they are placed in working hostels or some type of place which works as halfway homes before they are independently reintegrated into the society. Then comes reintegration when the child is restored into the family if he or she has a family, or into the community if he or she is self-sufficient and independent to earn his or her livelihood. And last is repatriation. This provision works for cross-border victim support, and if needed, the NGOs and government agencies can work for safe repatriation of victims to their country of origin. So if any person from neighboring countries is found in India, this provision helps them help their self-repartition to their country. Or if a person is found in such circumstances, Indian national is found in these activities outside India, and these provision makes for the safe repartition of that person back to India. So this scheme is a very comprehensive scheme which tries to help not only the children but to maintain a good society. And lastly, we will talk about the integrated child protection scheme, in which the holistic plan of action is prepared for the prevention and combating trafficking in human beings, with special focus to children and women. Under this scheme, the improved institutional care, quality non-institutional care, and alternative care is provided to children in difficult circumstances. Also, if needed, counseling and family support is given to these children. They are given training and capacity building training, and this child protection scheme also have provisions for child tracking system, and under this a website for missing children is created for easy monitoring and rescue of children. This scheme also focus on street children, trafficked children, children in need of care and protection, children in conflict with law, HIV AIDS affected children, adoption and foster care issue, or any other issue which is related with general health and well-being of children. So if we see, this integrated child protection scheme is an umbrella term which tries to work for and help all kind of children who are living in different circumstances. Under this scheme, a toll free children helpline 1098 and a women helpline 1091 is established, on which any person can report about any such women and children who might be needing help. The missing children website is developed, in which we can have real-time monitoring of children who are missed from their homes and who are away from their homes. And Swadhar shelter homes and short stay homes have also been created for those who have been rescued or found in different circumstances to help their children. So if we think there are many provisions in the constitution and many legal provisions are there in Indian legal system, and also many schemes have been started by the government for helping children in these difficult circumstances, and especially for curbing the incidences of child trafficking. However, the efficacy of all these measures are dependent on an effective system which is yet to take place. So with this, I will end this lecture here. Thank you for your patience listening. If you have any question and concern, you can always discuss it with me on various communication channels available. And also you can visit my YouTube channel for exploring more videos and lectures. Thank you. Stay safe. Jai Hind.